Yesterday, I was dealing with national income. Under that, I had covered GNP, NNP, GDP, NDP, and national income. I was covering yesterday. Okay. So, national income refers to the sum of total of all incomes earned by resource suppliers, land owners, laborers, capital owners, and managers or management entrepreneurs for their contribution of land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurial ability, which are used in the year's net production. Okay. So, from the viewpoint of resource suppliers, national income measures the incomes they have earned for their current contributions to production. So, national income, it represents contribution of land, contribution of labor, contribution of capital, and contribution of entrepreneurship to current year's total production in the country. From the viewpoint of business, which employs all these resources, national income measures the resource cost. So from the point of view of owners of the resources, it is income. From the point of view of those who use the resources, it is a cost. Because the businessmen or the manufacturers, they have to pay rent to the landowners. It is a cost. They have to pay wages to the laborers. Again, it is a cost. They have to pay interest to the capital owners. It is a cost. And they have to pay to the managers. So all these items are cost items from the point of view of business. So national income reflects the market cost of the economic resources which have been used in the creation of current year's production. I hope it is clear. Then the next concept is personal income, that is individuals' income. Okay, so personal income is the sum of all incomes actually received by all individuals or households during a given year. So the word to be stressed here is received. Okay, the word which has to be given importance is the income actually received. Okay, so personal income is the sum of all incomes actually received by all individuals or households during a given year. So some income is earned but not actually received by households. Okay, so I have to explain this. Some income is earned but not actually received by households. Suppose my income is 1 lakh rupees per month. Okay, suppose my income is 1 lakh rupees per month. I will not be able to take all the 1 lakh rupees home. ಒಂದು ತಿಂಗಳ ನನ್ನ ಸಂಬಳ 1 ಲಕ್ಷ ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಇದ್ರೆ ಆ 1 ಲಕ್ಷ ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಅಷ್ಟನ್ನು ನಾನು ಮನೆಗೆ ತಗೊಂಡು ಹೋಗೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಪೇ ದ ಇನ್ಶೂರೆನ್ಸ್ ಪ್ರೀಮಿಯಂ, ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಪೇ ದ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸಸ್, ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಪೇ ಮೆನಿ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ದೋ ಐ ಅರ್ನ್ ಇಟ್, ಐ ವಿಲ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ಏಬಲ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ದ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ಅಮೌಂಟ್ ಹೋಮ್. That's why it says actually received, not just earned. Example, social security contributions like group insurance, provident fund, undistributed corporate profits. Okay, now Suppose I have invested in the shares of some companies. Okay, I have invested money in the shares of some companies. And when the company earns profit, I will get a share in that profit, and it is called as dividend. Suppose this year the company decides we will not distribute the profit earned by the company. Instead of that, we will reinvest that profit into business. It is possible. Okay. The company may decide, instead of distributing the profit earned by the company among all the shareholders, it will reinvest that profit into business. Then that corporate profit is undistributed. Though we earn it, we don't receive it. Okay, so all these items, group insurance, provident fund, and undistributed corporate profits, okay, they are not actually received, though they are earned. Some income is received but not earned. Sometimes individuals receive the income but they don't earn it in that year. For example, pension. Okay, so AMB0080. People get pension. The people who get pension, they don't contribute to production in that year. They get pension for the contribution they have made in the past 25 years or 30 years, not this year. Okay, so pension is received, but it is not earned this year. Similarly, insurance payments. Suppose somebody meets with an accident or they are hospitalized. For that, they get the insurance payment. They don't earn it that year, but they receive it that year. So these items have to be considered when we talk about personal income. So national income is a measure of the income earned, whereas personal income is a measure of income received. Okay. So to calculate personal income, we must deduct income which is earned but not received, and add income which is received but not earned during the current year. So personal income is equal to national income minus social security contribution like provident fund, insurance premium, and so on. Social security contribution minus corporate taxes, because we have not received the undistributed corporate taxes. Corporate taxes, because we pay the corporate tax, we don't receive it. Undistributed corporate profits plus transfer payments. Transfer payments are the money which is received but not earned, like pension and insurance payments. So transfer payments, they refer to the insurance payments and the pension amount. Undistributed corporate profits, that is retained earnings, means these are corporate profits that are neither paid as corporate taxes nor paid to shareholders as dividends, but reinvested in business. As I mentioned earlier, it is reinvested in business. So they are income earned by shareholders but not received. Of course, they are not paid as taxes. They are reinvested in business. Corporate taxes against profits earned by a business during a given year. If the business earns profit, on that profit, certain percentage has to be paid as tax to the government, and that is called as corporate tax. Then disposable income. Dispose means which we can spend. Disposable income or disposable personal income, both are same. So disposable income is that part of personal income available for spending after the payment of direct taxes, including income tax, property tax, etc., to the government. Suppose I get 1 lakh rupees, out of that I have to pay insurance premium maybe 10,000 rupees, then provident fund amount another 10,000 rupees. So out of 1 lakh rupees, 20,000 goes for the social security aspects. Now remaining is 80,000. Out of 80,000, I may have to pay a tax of 15,000 rupees. So out of 80,000, 15,000 rupees goes away. So I'll be left with only 65,000 rupees to spend in that month. Okay, that is disposable income. After deducting all the social security payments, after deducting the direct tax or the property tax, whatever that is remaining, which I can spend, is called disposable income. So disposable income is equal to personal income minus direct taxes. So that is the amount. Disposable income is the amount which is available for consumption, and whatever is left after consumption is savings. Suppose my disposable income is 65,000 rupees per month, out of which I pay 50,000 rupees for my house rent, then school fees, then all the grocery items, vegetables and other things. So 50,000 rupees is my consumption expenditure. Remaining 15,000 is my savings. So consumption 50,000 plus savings 15,000, total is 65,000. That is the disposable income. Then per capita income. Per capita income is the income per head of population. So if you divide the total national income by the total population of the country, we get the income per head of the country, that is per capita income. So per capita income is equal to total national income divided by total population. Now this is the circular flow of goods and services and factor payments, or it is also called as wheel of wealth, Sampattina Chakra, wheel of wealth. So here we have the households, the families, the individuals on the one side, and we have firms, the businesses, on the other side. So households, they supply resources, land, labor, capital, and management. So these resources are supplied by households to the firms, the manufacturers. And the firms supply goods and services to households. So households provide services, and the firms provide the goods and services to households. Okay, now the households make payment to the firms, consumption expenditure. For the goods and services they receive, the households make the money payment to the firms. And for the resource services received, the firms make payment to the households. So money income payment to households by firms, also called as factor payments, or it includes rent, wages, interest, and profit to the households. So this inner circle is called as the inner circuit. This portion is called as real flow because it includes land, labor, capital, goods, and services. So it is called as real flow. And outer circuit, okay, where money payment is done by households and money payment is done by firms, it is called as money flows because in the outer circuit, only money is flowing from households to firms and firms to households. This is the wheel of wealth or the circular flow of goods and services and factor payments. Now coming to measurement of national income, how the national income is measured. There are three methods available for calculating the national income. One is the output method. The second one is the income method. And the third one is the expenditure method. So national income can be measured using either the output method or the income method or the expenditure method. The result should be the same. The national income figure you get must be the same. But what, which is the best method? So which is the best way to calculate the national income? They say the best way to arrive at national income is to employ all the three methods so as to cross-check the figures. Okay, so employ, use all the three methods and cross-check the values you get. Suppose there is difference in the values you get in different methods, then you have to check where there is error and correct it. Okay, so the purpose of using all the three methods and working out national income is to ensure greater accuracy in the estimation of national income. Which is the organization which works out, which estimates the national income? So it is done by the Central Statistical Organization. Estimation of national income in India is usually prepared by the Central Statistical Organization, which comes under the central government. Okay, it is a central government organization, central government department, the Central Statistical Organization, which estimates the national income every year. Now we'll look into each one of these three methods. So first one is output method, or also referred to as the production method. Now, how do we calculate national income using the output method? The economy is divided into different sectors, such as agriculture sector, mining sector, manufacturing sector, small enterprises sector, commerce sector, transport sector, communication sector, etc., and so on. So there are many other sectors. So first, the economy is divided into different sectors. Then market values of all the final goods and services produced in all sectors of the country in a given year are added. What is the total production, value of total production in agriculture sector? What is the value of total production in mining sector? Value of total production in the manufacturing sector in that year. So the value of total production in each sector is added up to get the national income. The sum total of all these values is called as GNP. Depreciation amount of plant and machinery used in the process of production is deducted from GNP to get NNP. So GNP minus depreciation gives you NNP. This method enables us to trace the origin of national income. So what is the total national income? And from agriculture sector, how much is the contribution to national income? From mining sector, what is the contribution to national income? So we can trace the origin of the national income aggregate, that is total national income, to the different sectors of the economy. How much comes from agriculture? How much comes from mining? How much comes from transport, communication, and so on? Therefore, it is called as national income by industrial origin. Okay, national income by industrial origin. National income from agriculture, from mining, from manufacturing sector, from transport sector, and so on. So by industrial origin. So it reveals the relative importance of different sectors of the economy. So what is the contribution? What is the percentage of national income from agriculture sector? So what is its importance? So importance of different sectors of the economy by showing their respective contribution to the national income. When we got independence, the contribution of agriculture sector to total national income was more than 50%, but now it has come down to around 16% or 17%. So the importance of agriculture sector in the national income has reduced over the years. So output method helps to find out this. Agriculture, it was more than 50% earlier. Now it has come down to a little more than 15%. Then the second method of measuring national income, estimating national income, is the income method. National income estimation is attempted from the distribution side. Distribution of the total production among the different sources of or resources, land, labor, capital, and so on. So what is the income earned by land owners? What is the income earned by labor owners? What is the income earned by capital owners? And what is the income owned by the entrepreneurs? Income method. It is calculated by adding up the rents on land, wages or salaries of employees, interest on capital, and profits of entrepreneurs. That's why it is called as income method. It indicates the distribution of national income among different income groups such as landowners, workers, capitalists, and entrepreneurs. So it is also called as national income by distributive shares. Shares of whom? Shares of landowners, labor owners, capital owners, and entrepreneurs. So distribution of income among all these owners of resources. So it is also referred to as distributive shares. Then the third one is the expenditure method or the outlay method. National income is calculated by summing up, taking the total of all consumption expenditure and investment expenditure made by all individuals as well as the government of a country during a year. Okay, consumption expenditure, investment expenditure made by individuals as well as government in a given year gives us the expenditure, national income by expenditure.
Recording in progress.
Third one is the net foreign investment, net spending by foreign nationals or foreign firms and foreign governments for the country's goods and services. Now, on Indian goods, that is the net foreign investment. Okay, government expenditure, what the government spends on the purchase of goods and services. So if you add up all the four, personal consumption expenditure, gross domestic private investment, net foreign investment and government expenditure, we get the national income by expenditure method or national income by outlay method. Now coming to the importance of national income estimation. Why should we estimate the national income? It tells us the overall production performance of the country. In the production of goods and services, where the country stands. Second one is per capita income gives an idea about the average standard of living of the people. ಜನರ ಜೀವನ ಮಟ್ಟ ಹೇಗಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಹೇಳುತ್ತೆ. ಇಟ್ ಟೆಲ್ಸ್ ಅಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡರ್ಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ, ವಿಚ್ ಇಂಡಿಕೇಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡರ್ಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್, ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಪರ್ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಇನ್ಕಮ್. ದೆನ್ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಇನ್ಕಮ್ ಎಸ್ಟಿಮೇಷನ್ ಓವರ್ ಎ ಪೀರಿಯಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಟೈಮ್. ಇಫ್ ಯು ಎಸ್ಟಿಮೇಟ್ ದ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಇನ್ಕಮ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಇಯರ್, ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ಟೆಲ್ಸ್ ಅಸ್ ವೆದರ್ ದ ಇಕಾನಮಿ ಇಸ್ ಗ್ರೋಯಿಂಗ್ over the years, whether the economy is stagnant over the years, or whether the economy is declining over the years. If the national income is increasing every year, then we say economy is growing. If the national income is the same year after year, then we say the economy is stagnant. If the national income is decreasing over the years, year after year, the national income is decreasing, then we say the economy is declining. It shows, the national income estimation shows the contribution made by various sectors of the economy to the national income. What is the contribution of agriculture sector? What is the contribution of industrial sector? And so on. Then, importance of national income estimation continued. So the fifth importance is it reveals the equality or inequality in distribution of income, because by income method we know how much is the rent earned by the landowners, how much is the wages earned by the laborers, how much is the interest earned by the capitalists, how much is the profit earned by the entrepreneurs. So it tells us whether this distribution of income among landowners, laborers, capital owners and so on is equal or unequal among various categories of the people in the country. Then it provides figures on consumption, saving and investment in the economy. How much is the total expenditure on consumption, how much is the total savings in the country, and how much is the investment in the country. So this helps in planning for economic growth. Now there is Niti Aayog. Niti Aayog prepares the plans. Baswanappa avare, daivittu nimma mic na yavaglu mute madidi. So it helps in planning for the economic growth of the country. So we have Niti Aayog, earlier we had Planning Commission. So Planning Commission was preparing 5-year plans. Now Niti Aayog also prepares the plans for the economic growth of the country, and national income, especially the consumption, saving and investment, helps the Niti Aayog in preparing the plans. Then national income estimates are valuable guide for developing economic policies. The government comes out with the policies. Niti Aayog helps the government in formulating the economic policies for the development. So the national income figures, it helps. then it helps in comparing the standard of living and level of economic welfare in different countries. We'll say which is the richest country, which is the poorest country, which is the developing country. So national income figures are as one which is having good standard of living, poor standard of living, rich country, poor country, and so on. Difficulties in measurement of national income. It is not that easy. Estimating national income is not that easy. What are the problems we face in estimation of national income? In many developing countries, statistical data are not properly maintained. Okay, many countries, they do not have proper statistical data to work out the national income. How much is the agriculture production? How much is the production in the industrial sector? How much is the production in mining sector? What is the income generated in the transportation sector? Many countries, they don't have reliable figures. They may have some crude figures, they may not have reliable figures. Second difficulty is, in developing countries, due to illiteracy and ignorance, most producers do not keep record of quantity and value of their output. Most of the farmers in India, they don't keep records. Okay, so if you go approach them and ask them immediately, they'll be able to recollect, remember, and give you the information, but they don't keep the records. Most of the farmers, they don't keep records. Most of the small businessmen also, they don't keep the record. Third one is prevalence of non-monetized transactions. Okay, in developing countries, non-monetized transaction is, even today in villages, in many villages, the payment are made in terms of grains and not money. Okay, on lease basis they give. Guttige aadharad mele kodtare for harvesting. If you harvest 1 acre of jowar, you'll get 3 bags of jowar or 2 bags of jowar, whatever that negotiation takes place. Okay, that is non-monetized transaction. So the value of such transaction will not enter into the records, will not enter into statistical data. So prevalence of non-monetized transactions in developing countries, a considerable part of output does not come into market at all. So it may not get into your statistical data at all, like wages in kind, payment in kind, and so on. The fourth difficulty is non-monetized transactions such as services of housewives and farm output consumed at home. Actually, our mothers, wives, daughters, they contribute through their household chores, the work they do at the household level. But we never estimate what is the value of contribution made by the housemakers, the housewives, the wives, the daughters, the mothers. We never estimate it. So it never gets into the national income. Then, income arising out of activities of the foreign firms in a country. Many a times, profits earned by foreign firms are credited to parent companies. They will directly send it to their parent companies in their countries. So it may not enter into the national income here. So these are the difficulties in measurement of national income. If you have any questions on this, you may ask. Otherwise, I'll move to the next chapter, that is the factors of production. I'll move to the next chapter. ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಇದ್ದೀರಲ್ಲ ಸಂತೋಷ. ಓಕೆ, ಟುಡೇ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಮೇಲ್ಡ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಡೆಡ್ ಸಿಲೆಬಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್, ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿಟೈಲ್ಡ್ ಸಿಲೆಬಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಟೀಚರ್ಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸೆಂಟ್ ಟು ದ ಎಕ್ಸಾಮಿನೇಷನ್ ಸೆಂಟರ್. ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಮೇಲ್ಡ್ ಟು ಯುವರ್ ಸಿ ಆರ್ ಗವಿಸಿದ್ದೇಶ್ವರ್ ಪಾಟೀಲ್, ಹಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ share it with all the classmates. Okay, so you'll know which topics or which chapters are yet to be covered. Okay, now I'll take up the factors of production. The factors of production, they're all the resources that we use in producing wealth. Okay, the production of wealth needs the cooperation of several factors. Example, to produce banana, we need land to cultivate. It is a factor of production. We need labor to do planting, weeding, harvesting. A factor of production. We need money to buy fertilizers, pesticides, and so on. A factor of production. We need water to irrigate, factors of production. Tractor to transport, factor of production. An organizer to coordinate all these activities, factor of production. And many other things, not only these six items listed here, there are many other items. This is only an example. So these are all the factors of production. But traditionally, we classify all these items into only four groups that we'll look into in the next slides. The traditional classification of factors of production: land, labor, capital, and management or organization. But modern view of factors of production, it says, anything which is used in production is a factor of production. So there are a number of factors of production like seeds, fertilizers, manual labor, tractor drivers, and so on. They're all factors of production as per the modern view, but the traditional classification, it has only four: land, labor, capital, and organization or management. So what is the meaning of the factors of production? These are the resources and or, it may be both or any one of them, resources and or services which are essential for the production of a commodity are called factors of production. What are the characteristics of factors of production? Substitutability. That means a factor can be a substitute for another factor in the production process without affecting the output. One factor can be substituted for other factor without affecting the production output. Example, a machine can replace human labor in harvesting of paddy. So machine substitutes for human labor in harvesting of paddy. Machine can replace bullock pairs and human labor in land preparation. So factors of production have substitutability. Second characteristic is complementarity. Complementarity means if you want to use one, you need the other one also. The two factors, they go together. Complementarity, substitutability, using one instead of the other. Complementarity, using both. The factors are said to be complementary if increase in the use of one factor leads to increase in the use of another factor. For example, machine needs human labor for operating the machine. The two are complementary factors in this sense. Okay, so if you want to operate the machine, you need a person, operator. So machine and the operator, the worker, they are complementary. They go together. The two are complementary factor in this sense. So human labor and capital have both supplementary and complementary characters, or both are substitutes and complements. Then third characteristic of factors of production is specificity. That means you can use a particular factor of production only for that purpose. Specifically for that purpose, you cannot use it for any other purpose. A factor is said to be specific when it is used for only one purpose. Example, spare parts of a particular machine. You cannot use the spare parts of one machine for the other. You cannot use the spare parts of tractor to repair a pump set. Okay. Low-lying area with standing water. If in your farm, in your farm, there is a low-lying area where the rainwater gets stagnated, where the rainwater gets collected, there is standing water, only paddy can be cultivated. Specificity. That land where there will be standing water always, you can cultivate only paddy. So specificity. Then the fourth one is versatility. That means the same factor can be used for more than one purpose. A factor is said to be versatile when it can be put to several uses. Example, tractor can be used for plowing. Tractor can also be used for transporting. Versatility. Then we'll look into each one of the factors of production: land, labor, capital, and management or organization. In ordinary language, when we say land, it means soil or the top layer of the earth. In the ordinary language, when we say land, it refers to the top layer of the earth or the soil. But in economics, land has a different meaning. In economics, when we say land, it refers to all things given by nature. Everything which is given by nature, free of cost, and which is not capable of being produced by human effort. Human beings, they cannot produce land. Those factors, okay, which is given by nature. For example, land surface, man cannot produce land. Oceans, lakes, rivers, mineral deposits, rainfall, sunshine, and so on. All of them put together is called as land. In economics, when we say land, it includes all these natural items, natural resources, which cannot be produced by man. What is the importance of land or the functions of land? Land is the original source of all material wealth. So everything, including human beings, maninda kaya. So even the human beings, we have come out of the land. Okay, land is the original source of all material wealth. Land provides space and anchorage for the crops to grow, for the trees to grow, space is required. Land provides the space. For the trees and crops to grow, anchorage is required. When rain comes, the plants, the trees, the crops should not be washed away. When there is strong wind, when the wind is blowing, the plants, trees, and crops should not be blown away. So it needs anchorage. ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಅದು ಸ್ಥಿರವಾಗಿ ನಿಂತ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಜಾಗ ಬೇಕು. ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊವೈಡ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್. ಓಕೆ, ಬೋತ್ ಸ್ಪೇಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಂಕರೇಜ್ ಇಸ್ ಪ್ರೊವೈಡೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್. ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಆಕ್ಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಎ ರೆಪಾಸಿಟ್ರಿ. ರೆಪಾಸಿಟ್ರಿ ಇಸ್ ಕಲೆಕ್ಷನ್, ಸಂಚಯ. ಸೊ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಆಕ್ಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಎ ರೆಪಾಸಿಟ್ರಿ ಆಫ್ ಫಿಸಿಕಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್. ಆಲ್ ದ ಫಿಸಿಕಲ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರ್ಸ್, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ by the land. It is a collection. Quantity and quality of agriculture wealth in a country depends on land. If the land is fertile, then the quality of agriculture produced in the country will be good. If the soil is infertile, then the crop, the output, the agriculture production will be of poor quality. What are the characteristics or the features of land? Land is a free gift of nature. All other factors are man-made. Except land, everything else is man-made. But in economics, when we say land, it includes everything which is naturally given to us. Second, there is no cost of production. There is no cost of production of land because land is not produced by human beings. Land is permanent. It cannot be completely destroyed. You can destroy the fertility of land, but land itself is permanent. Other factors can be destroyed. Tractors can be destroyed. Labor can be destroyed. Buildings can be destroyed. The land as such is permanent. Land is limited in supply. You cannot increase the availability of land. Otherwise, the price of land would not have gone to such high level in Bangalore. 1 crore rupees per acre, 4 crore rupees per acre, because availability of land or supply of land is limited. You cannot increase the supply of land. So supply of land is price inelastic. Whatever may be the price, whether it is increased to 1 crore rupees per hectare per acre or 10 crore rupees per acre, you cannot increase the supply of land. So supply of land is price inelastic. Man cannot increase the volume of land, but its fertility may be increased. So supply of other factors can be increased. Number of machines can be increased. Number of buildings can be increased, but not land. Then characteristics continued. Land is immobile. You cannot bring fertile land from Kaveri Basin to, say, Chitradurga or somewhere. It is not possible. Or maybe even to South Canara district. The soil is acidic there. You cannot take fertile land from in the plain area to the coastal area. It is not possible. Land is immobile. It lacks geographical mobility. Moving fertile land from Bihar and placing it in the deserts of Rajasthan is not possible. Labor and capital are mobile. Land varies in quality. Fertility level varies from place to place. Within the farm, 2 plots may be varying in their fertility. It is possible. Seventh characteristic is land is subject to law of diminishing marginal returns. If you go on using more and more seeds, if you go on applying more and more fertilizers or more and more water, the increase in production is subject to law of diminishing marginal returns. What is law of diminishing marginal returns? I have already explained. Additional output from land goes on declining with every increased application of labor and capital in cultivation. Then the second factor of production is labor. In the ordinary language, labor means any physical work done by a person, carrying something on the head, carrying something on the back, digging something, plowing. Okay, all physical work done by a person is called as labor in the ordinary language, but in economics, it means both physical and mental work. Okay, physical work as well as mental work done by a person to earn an income is referred to as labor. So free labor is not labor in economics. Free labor is no labor in economics. All labor in the economic sense is productive. Okay. Now, what are the characteristics or the features of labor? Labor cannot be separated from laborer. So you cannot separate labor, the work done, from the laborer, his ability to work, rather, not the work done, the ability to work cannot be separated from the laborer. A laborer's work has to be delivered in person. He has to physically go there and do the work, so it has to be done in person. A laborer, a doctor, a lawyer, a professor, okay, professor, I'll come to later on. A laborer, a doctor, a lawyer, they have to attend to work in person. The lawyer has to go to the court and argue there. The doctor has to go to hospital and treat the patient. The laborer has to go to the field and work there. They have to attend to work in person. Suppose a professor writes a book. It is a result of professor's labor, but book is not labor. Book itself is not labor. Book is a product of labor of professor. It is a material good. Okay. Book is a material good. Book is not labor, but book is the result of labor by professor. Laborer sells his service, not himself. Laborer does not sell himself. A laborer sells his service. Labor is less mobile. Compared to capital, labor is less mobile. Money from America or money from India to America can easily go. But an Indian going to America, he has a lot of restrictions. Okay. Capital is more mobile. Labor is comparatively less mobile. Land is immobile. So labor is less mobile than goods and capital. Labor differs in efficiency. Okay. All are not equally efficient, either physically or mentally. Even in your class, you are about 91 students, but 94 students are present. I'm happy. Okay. So all are not equally efficient. All the students are not equally efficient, both physically and mentally. Labor is also not equally efficient. Efficiency differs from person to person. for the same person from time to time or place to place. If I am very happy, I'll be most efficient. If I am very sad, if I am very tired, then I'll be least efficient. So from time to time, the efficiency varies. From place to place, efficiency varies. If you are in a temperate country, if you are in a cold country, if you are in European country, your efficiency level may be higher. But if you are in a desert, okay, if you are in a desert, then because of such a heat, your efficiency level will be lower. So it varies from place to place. Fifth characteristic is labor is more perishable than any other commodity. Easily it gets exhausted. You have to use when I am ready to work. If you don't use my labor today, tomorrow you cannot get my work for 16 hours. Suppose I have the ability, I have the efficiency to work for 8 hours in a day. You have to get, suppose you are the manager, I am the worker, okay? Then you cannot get my work done tomorrow if you don't get my work done today. Suppose I have the ability to work for 8 hours, and as the manager you say, Shrikanmurthy, you don't work today, you can take rest. So I don't work. That 8 hours labor is lost. Tomorrow also you say, okay, you don't work. Another 8 hours of labor is gone. Third day, if you say, day before yesterday you didn't work, yesterday you didn't work, now today you have to work for 24 hours. It will not be possible. Day after tomorrow, I'll be able to work for only 8 hours because my ability to work is only 8 hours in a day. So those 8 hours of today, 8 hours of tomorrow is gone forever. So labor is more perishable than any other commodity. A day lost without work is lost forever. That's what I said earlier. Laborers do not have the same bargaining capacity as employees. It was so earlier. When Karl Marx, he wrote Das Kapital, the communist countries, the social countries were formed. It was so, but today it may not be entirely true. The situations might have changed today. Laborers do not have the same bargaining capacity as employees. That means the capitalists can control the laborers. That's what it says. Trade unions provide laborers collective bargaining power, which removes the weakness of labor in this respect. If all the workers come together, they can dictate terms on the management also, and we have seen in many places. So I'll stop here. Okay, I'll stop here. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Do you have any question?
So please explain the last point once again, sir.
Laborers do not have the same bargaining capacity as the employees. It was so earlier, not entirely true today. What it says is the laborers were exploited by the employers. Laborers were exploited by the employers. Okay? Because the laborers, they didn't have the capacity to bargain with the employer. You might have seen in 20, 30 years ago films of 20, 30 years old films, okay? Amitabh Bachchan or Dharmendra or those films, or even before that, Biswajit and those were the heroes, Ashok Kumar and so on. In those films, the workers, the factory workers, the field workers, the agricultural laborers were exploited by the rich people because the workers didn't have the bargaining capacity. But today, the situation has changed. And if you want the workers to come and work on your field, you have to give higher wages. Not only that, you have to give them some incentives. You may have to give them food. You may have to give them liquor. In some places, it is happening. Okay? So that is one thing. And related to this, if there are trade unions, if all the laborers join together and form a union, then they will have a bargaining power and they can dictate terms to the employers. That's what it says.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. If there are no more questions. Yes, I'll stop sharing and
thank you, sir.
Bye. Bye, everybody. Bye. Have a nice time. Channagiri, Jopar Wagiri. Bye.
Record.